To start with, let me go to the history of the people of the Vume. Originally, we, the people of Vume, were a Kan-speaking group. Our forefathers, or our predecessors, migrated from a place in a Kan area called Dangera. At that time, it was a kingdom. We had to migrate because of some reasons, particularly because of the ravages of war. Dangera was the only state at that time. And other chiefs were paying tribute to the Dangeraheni at the time. It came to a time when tribal wars broke out. The Asantes wanted to supersede the Dangeras. This brought about a war. At the time, the king of Dangera, or the Dangeraheni, was called Intim Jakari. My predecessor, Akuno, was next to Intim Jakari at the time. So when the Intim Jakari war broke out, and the Asantes were, in fact, capturing them, my predecessor, Nana Akuno, decided to leave the area. Because when the Dangera state was defeated by the Asantes, the result was that they had to be subjected to the Asantehene at the time. So, my predecessor did not want to be subservient to the Asantes. So he had to leave the place with a group of people. They went through series of places. Some of the places they temporarily settled were called Ketekre, Apurede, Akwapim, and so on. They were all in the Akan area until they came to a spot along the Volta River, where they crossed the Volta to the other side. That place was called Senchi. So the first permanent settlement made by my predecessor, Nana Akuno, was called Vume. It was an Akan word, Vume, in Akan meaning rest. So this word, Vume, has been adulterated to what we are calling Vume today. Some people interpret it as if we came in a canoe down this area. Canoe meaning Vu, Tojivu. So people who did not understand our history very well say that because we came in canoe, that's where we are called Vumes. That was not the history. The history was that the name, the original name, was Vume, which had been adulterated to what? Vume today. Now, at Vume, which was later called Togome, far away near Pong Akuse area there, there was another war between the Vumes and then the Akwamus. For the security of the stool, we had to take the stool from Vume to a safety place, which is here, Vume here. In our journey, during our journey, my predecessor had four strong wing chiefs. They were the divisions, the four main divisions of the Vume traditional area. Now, one chief was called Banahini, another was Efutu Kweku Ado, the next was Asem Nkwonta, and the fourth divisional chief was Kata. Now, in our journey, when we were to move from Vume, because of the war between the Akwamus and the Vumes, my predecessor had to leave the Benkumhini, that's the left wing chief, there to guard the land, to make sure that the land there was safe. So the wing chief there, called Asem Nkwonta, was put there to take charge of the land. And he was the Benkumhini. The current chief there now is the sixth, Asem Nkwonta the sixth. He's there right now at Vume Togoma. When we came to settle here, there was another war between the Vumes and then the Adans. So still, for the security of the Sioux, the reason is, when your Sioux at the time was captured by an enemy, then all the subjects under that Sioux become subjects of the conqueror. You understand what I'm saying? So for the security of the Sioux, it had to be taken to a safe place. So the Sioux had to be taken to another area. Now, in the process, the Adontinhini of the Vume traditional area, who was Utuo Banahini at the time, who was helping Akono in his wars, had to be put here to guard the land, just like in Togoma. So that chief, Utuo Banahini, his descendant, is now the fourth, the Banahini the fourth now, who is my current Adontinhini of the Vume traditional area. In fact, he is next to me in chieftaincy. He is sitting right now here. Now, when we move from here, we had to go to another area for the security of the Sioux with two other wing chiefs, that is the Chidomhini and the Nifahini. Banahini was the Adontinhini, was put here. Okay. So we left and we found another place. That place was called Boviaji. Boviaji. It shares boundary with Akachi and North Tongu. So at Boviaji, the stool was peacefully settled there because there was peace there. And the two other wing chiefs had to stay with the stool. But traditionally, the two wing chiefs cannot stay at the same place. So one of them had to move forward to another place. So the Nifahini, who was Efutu Kweku Ado, was put at Boviaji to take charge of the land, while the Chidomhini, Nana Kata, moved to found a new place called Srekwe. So, Vume Togome, Vume Dugame here, this is our traditional capital, Vume Boviaji and Vume Srekwe are the four wing areas. Divisions of the traditional area, headed by divisional chiefs. namely Asamugonta, Banahini, Adu, and Kata. And in fact, they are under the paramount stool. These chiefs also had their sub-chiefs. And one of the sub-chiefs of Nana Banahini is right with me here on my left, is Togbe Kwasi Anatu III. There are other sub-chiefs who are not here. And the other wing chief there too had his own sub-chiefs. All of them owe allegiance to me through my divisional chiefs. Now, a part of the history says that women were also very important during wars because they provided food for the warriors at the battlefield. And so, some women who were brave enough to march foot to foot with the men at the battlefield now have become the queen mothers of the area. And one of these important women was Nana Adobia Akeche. Incidentally, Nana Adobia Akeche, my queen mother, is now a police woman. Is in Accra, is working in Accra. Is a police lady, an officer in the police service. She should have been here traditionally, but you know, as a government worker, and in fact, this program is so prompt that the information could not reach her on time. That's why she's not with us here. And we are sorry for that. Another queen mother was Adukua. Adukua is the queen mother to the Divisional Chief there at Togoma. And then another one is Akeche. That one comes from the line of Adobia Akeche the Fourth. He's the queen mother to the Nifahini at Kobiaji. They are there. Now, so you see that briefly, this how our history is. Many people think that we were Evans. No, we are not Evans. We are a Ghanaian-speaking group. But because we stayed with the Evans for so long a time, in fact, more than 300 years back, and we have done so many things in common with the Evans, people think we are originally we are Evans. But if you look at the names of our stools, like Akuno, like Banahini, like Asamugonta, like Efutu Kweku, like Kata, other chiefs like Osodia, Kumsa, Gidi, Adobia, Adokuya, you see that all these are Akan names. And we are proud of that. Our culture is just like that of the Akan, similar to Akan, because we came from the Akan area, except that today we are speaking Ewe. It's just like with other tribes who migrated from different place, staying at a different place for a long time. They capture that area's language, and so their own language, the indigenous language, they tend to forget about it. But still, there are some signs showing that originally they were that people. The colonial government identified Vume as a state on its own. Yes, we do not owe allegiance to any tribe or any group of people. We are on own. That's why historians, look at this book. Those people who attended middle school in Ghana, the short history of Ghana, if you read it thoroughly, you see the role my predecessor played in Ghana. In fact, my stool was one of the oldest stools in Ghana. If you look at this history, written by E.W. Wall, I think a British writer. If you look at this book, The Ewe in Pre-Colonial Times, what I told you briefly has been captured in this book here. If you read page 16, 17, you see that in the lower Volta area of which we are calling Tongu today, that is the only tribe which has been described as having come from Dentra. It is here. And the first settlement being Vume, it is in this book. Historians have identified and recognized as a state on its own. It's here, black and white. The colonial government also still recognized us. That's why he signed a land treaty with one Charles Ruby Williams. We, the people of Vume, along among other chiefs in Tongu, signed a land treaty with one Charles Ruby Williams. This is an authentic document from National Archives. This agreement was signed in 1886. This is a document to that effect. It was my regent and the predecessor of my Adontinhini, and then the Omankrado of the area who signed this agreement on behalf of the people, the chiefs and people of Vume, alongside other Tongu chiefs. Document is here. In the year 1934-35, there was a Gold Coast Chiefs list for Vume. Your government at that time recognized us as chiefs and people of Vume traditional area. So the regent at the time in 1934-35 called Lajapo, and then the divisional chiefs Banahini, Ado, Kata, and Asam Nkonta, they have their name in this document, archives document. The colonial government, the British government, English government, also granted us, the Vumes, a tribunal, that is a court, giving us authority as chiefs to settle cases among our people. This is the document from National Archives. And in fact, this is a photocopy from this document. So in brief, this is our history. And if we come to the occupation of the people, of the Vumes, the women are farmers and particularly porters. They make pots. And they make pots manually. They use their hands. They use their strength. Everything in making pots. They have their local baking ground, the pots, And the men are farmers, fishermen. Unfortunately, on the part of the men, when the Volta River Authority created this artificial lake, that is bridging the river, the Akosombo Dam, the flow of the river suspended. The rainfall pattern also changed. And so the men are suffering because farming needs water, needs rain. And unfortunately, we don't know the technology in farming and all those things. So they depend on the hand, the hoe, the cutlass, and all that. So this has hampered our work drastically in such a way that, excuse me to say, the men, just like the women, have been caught in the poverty net. Why? Because the rainfall pattern has changed. We make a lot of farms, there's no rain, no water, things dry up, no good result, no yield. So they come back to square one, nothing, no dividend. And I tell you, they are hard-working people. My people are honest and hard-working men and women. But nature is such that you cannot challenge it, when, except that you have the technology that you can be able to challenge nature and the scientific know-how, that in a way you can challenge nature. But as it is, as people who are living in a deprived area and all that, it's very difficult for them to make their ends meet. And this is unfortunate. But still, we are trying very hard to go in contact with some benevolent people who can see our plight and perhaps assist us with the technology. If we can have the technology, I think we'll be able to move forward. And
you haven't introduced yourself yet.
Yeah, I'll come to that. Now, when we come to the development of the area, our people were able to establish their own school first. They contributed money in those days and built their own school. My Adontihini was a key role player in those days for establishing the RC primary school and then the middle school, now the JSS, the Junior Secondary School. See that the people are hardworking. If a group of people were able to establish their own school, pay their teachers, then you could imagine what sort of people they are. And if we can get some people who are advisors and who can direct us, I think we can do greater things in this area. Now, when we come to poetry, lest I forget, because the women naturally and traditionally were poets, they have taken the trouble to learn the modern way of making pots. Formerly, the men and the boys were not making pots. But now, The men also had joined the women in making the pots. Why? Because some small technology has come to the pottery site. Some volunteers have come to teach them how to use the potter's wheel to mold pots, different designs. And so I think you can see some of them when you came. Yeah, you have seen some of them. They have their small factories, and there's a young man who has also got his own factory, Boni. Is there just at the roadside there. And one lady also has a factory just along this route when going to Swakopee. Now, currently, a young man is trying to organize the women by trying to construct a baking spot for the women. And I think it's there. I don't know whether you have been shown.
Tomorrow, I think tomorrow.
Okay. Now, the factory is there. It's not functioning yet. It's a new thing which they have started. We are also trying to create a community center. We have acquired the land, and we have a site plan on it. But how to fund it is the problem. So it's lying there. Okay. VRA promised assisting us. No, but the promise is not forthcoming. So it's there. And when we come to education, our children are interested in schooling, in going to school. But because the parents, I may say, not well established financially, they find it difficult to cater for these boys and girls. It's rather unfortunate. But you know, after we have gone, it is these children who will inherit us. So we must try as much as possible to find a better position for them, so that if we have left, then they can occupy our positions and then even develop this community more than as we are seeing today. So I think for short, this is what I can tell you, or this is what I can tell the children of England.